Good evening. Hi, Sheriff, my Lord Lieutenant, Mr. Mayors, my Lords, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Bournemouth University. I'm delighted to be here this evening to host the High Sheriff of Dorset's Law Lecture and to be joined here this evening by so many distinguished guests. Thank you for coming. BU is on a transformational journey. In 2015, we entered the Times Higher Education Top 500 World University Rankings for the first time. And earlier this year, in January, we were included in the Times Higher Education World University Rankings for the top 200 most international universities. We are committed to developing global talent, the very best research, an outstanding educational experience, and unrivaled links with business and industry. Furthermore, we integrate these to provide a powerful fusion where the sum is greater than the parts, and therefore we maximise our social, economic and cultural impact. Now, this model is at the heart of our global success, but we also have a huge impact locally, so in the southwest, and most importantly, of course, in Dorset. And as a result, we've also risen in all the three major UK league tables. Now, economic growth has dominated the headlines this week, and in the southwest, BU is an engine of economic growth, and every day we contribute more than £1 million to the southwest economy. In Dorset, we have an important economic but also intellectual role to play, and we do that through hosting high-profile events such as the one this evening, collaborating with businesses on joint research projects, supplying highly qualified and highly motivated graduates to the local workforce, and also working with schools and colleges to raise aspirations and outcomes. So I hope that being on campus this evening will give you a sense of the excitement and the energy that is driving us forwards. And so once again, thank you for joining us. Now, before I introduce the High Sheriff, there are four points of housekeeping to mention. Firstly, this event is being filmed, streamed, and there will be a transcript available afterwards. Secondly, there is full Wi-Fi access, so please tweet and use social media. The hashtag is on the screen at the top there. Thirdly, there's no planned fire alarm, so if the alarm sounds, the exits are on the side, and BU staff will be there to show you where to gather. And finally, there's a reception in the atrium afterwards, and everyone is welcome to attend. So now it is my very great pleasure to introduce a great friend and strong supporter of the university, the High Sheriff of Dorset, Mr. Jennifer Coombs.
Thank you, Vice-Chancellor, my Lord Lieutenant, distinguished guests. Thank you so much for joining me tonight for the High Sheriff of Dorset's Law Lecture. I suppose under the title of Law Lecture, we may well have lured you here under false pretenses. It is our hope that it will start with a debate between the panellists and then broaden out into a wider conversation with you, the audience. Please feel free to participate fully. We will, I hope, leave plenty of time for that. The High Sheriff's Law Lecture used to be an annual event run largely for the benefit of Bournemouth University law students. It fell into abeyance a few years ago, but I am passionate about education and offering opportunities to the young people in Dorset. I consulted with previous High Sheriffs and received nothing but enthusiastic encouragement to revive the series. So here we are. I'm incredibly grateful to our most distinguished panel for agreeing to join me tonight for this lecture, and to Bournemouth University for this marvelous lecture theatre and so much support for this event, especially the office of Jim Andrews with Kerry Noble and Clare House Norman. I am almost at the end of my year as High Sheriff. How quickly it has gone. In the past year, I've been given direct access to various parts of the criminal justice system within Dorset. I have been privileged to visit prisons, meet ex-offenders, and to meet also those who work so hard to support individuals within the system. It has opened my eyes. Beautiful though it is to an outsider, Dorset has its own problems. From isolated rural areas to towns with pockets of deprivation, and our one-size-fits-all legal system can struggle to meet the needs of all. I can only see challenges increasing with budget cuts, changing demographics, and an aging physical infrastructure. Tonight is our chance to hear a very expert panel debate some of the current issues and then give us an opportunity to challenge them with our own questions. Without further ado, let me introduce our panel. The Right Honourable the Lord Neuberger of Abbotsbury, President of the Supreme Court of the United Kingdom. The Right Honourable the Lord Phillips of Worth Matravers, Bournemouth University's Chancellor and the inaugural President of the Supreme Court. Professor Roger Graef, visiting professor at Bournemouth University, BAFTA award-winning filmmaker, criminologist, and writer. And our chair, Mary Ann Sieghart, award-winning journalist and broadcaster. Thank you, and I hope you all enjoy the 2016 High Sheriff of Dorset's Law Lecture. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much for that introduction. Let me just explain how this is going to work. It's going to be a very brisk canter around the merits and demerits of the criminal justice system. In fact, more like a gallop, I suspect, because we're going to debate four questions. We're only going to have 10 minutes each. At the end of each 10 minutes, we're going to have a vote in the audience to see whether you agree or disagree with the question. And after those four questions, we're going to have a good 15 or 20 minutes of question and answer time where you can really ask pretty much whatever you like, and we'll try to get a debate going on the panel about that subject. I'm going to be a brutal chair. I'm going to keep all the panelists to 10 minutes in all, and we're going to start with the question, does public opinion have too much influence on sentencing? And I'm going to ask Nicholas Phillips to start.
Yes, it does, or at least what people think public opinion is, which isn't the same. Sentencing is there to punish people apart from anything else, and if the judges don't punish, people will take the law into their own hands. And it's said that punishment should fit the crime. Well, who decides how big the crime is? The answer is, today, it's Parliament. And Parliament passes acts of Parliament with maximum sentences. And the bigger the Parliament thinks the crime, the bigger the maximum sentence. So you get a bigger maximum for murder than you do for burglary, and a bigger maximum for burglary than you do for careless driving. And when Parliament passes these acts, it tries to reflect social attitudes. And I think it's absolutely right that it should do so. But governments also like to win elections, so they like to curry favour with the populace. And they think the populace like them to be tough on crime. And so we have seen, in my lifetime, Parliament jacking up minimum sentences to show they're tough on crime, with the result that our prison population has increased and is now far too full to reform people, and this is thoroughly unsatisfactory. That's one way public opinion has a bad effect. The other way can be on individual judges. They do their best to follow guidance given by the Sentencing Guidelines Council, which I used to chair, but they're human beings. And when there is in the press a tremendous campaign against a particular form of criminal behavior, that tends to be reflected in individual sentences. And I think we are seeing that now at the moment in relation to sexual offending. We are seeing, obviously, some sexual offenses are very serious indeed, such as rape, but some are less serious. But we are seeing sentences being imposed for less serious sexual offending, which when I started at the bar, you would have thought were probably being imposed for rape or even murder.
Roger Graef.
I certainly think public opinion is too strong an influence on sentencing for all the reasons Nick has said, but also because the public are wrong so much of the time about what the judges actually do. And the research that's been done on this is terribly interesting, because every time there's a group of people being given the details of a case, their general attitude may be very punitive, but they're much more likely to say, no, in this case, even the death penalty in America, it should not be applied in this case. So the real problem is that giving the public the information they need to make an intelligent judgment about this is very difficult when the media is in the fear business. And the real problem at the core of all this is adrenaline. It's a drug problem, and adrenaline is the drug. Because you can get it from a newspaper headline. You can get it. The Fear of Crime Committee that the Home Office founded, a little old lady in the Lake District who never left her home because of the Wimbledon strangler. She was so worried that they were going to attack her. So that sense in which they're peddling fear because bad news does sell newspapers distorts the ability of the public to understand the complexity of the law and the variables that judges use. But when there's a proper analysis of this, then the public turn out to be less punitive than both the judges had assumed and certainly the politicians and the media.
David Neuberger, isn't it true that the public actually believe that sentences are far shorter than they actually are in practice?
I think it can be quite complicated because sentences aren't always what they seem. Most prisoners who are sentenced to a term of years will end up doing significantly less in prison. But since this is meant to be a debate, let me put the other point of view. The two of the most fundamental features of a modern democratic society are the rule of law and freedom of expression. And the rule of law finds itself in the criminal system through Parliament, Acts of Parliament, and the judges passing sentences and the courts. But the other feature where freedom of expression finds its place is through the media. Now, the judges and the media have very different perceptions of life. Judges are very particular about each case. Most judgments are long and detailed. And on the other hand, journalists have to express themselves briefly and shortly and simply. So there's a great dichotomy between the two approaches. And it's inevitable that there will be a degree of conflict between them. Journalists also look for stories that are going to excite people. But if we live in a pluralistic society, we have to accept, I suggest, a degree of influence from the press that we may not like, but it's the price of a free society. And therefore, I suggest that there is a real argument for saying that even though we don't like the results sometimes, the price of a free press, the price of freedom of expression, is that we do have the influence that we do have in this country, and therefore it's not too great.
Roger,
yes, I did want to come back on that, because if we think about what the press cover in the way of crime, it's almost always violent. And in the case of child murders, for example, it's very rare. The Bulger case, the whole country was in a moral panic about that and almost produced mob rule, claiming, as it were, the justice system was collapsing. And the same with Sarah Payne, Baby P. And these cases just dominate the coverage of crime. So people who aren't interested, don't pay attention, think that's what the justice system is about and therefore assume that it's failing. And it isn't.
Of course, the reason, speaking as a journalist, the reason these cases dominate the coverage of crime is precisely because they are so rare. And that's right, why they're a big story. If they were commonplace, they wouldn't be all over the front pages.
But in the Bulger case, there was no difference year on year from the early 70s to the Bulger case, child murder, another child. It was one every other year. That's not a reason for a moral panic.
But what are you going to do about it? It's all very well railing against it. Are you going to curb the press's freedom to report it in the way they want?
Well,
it seems to me it's an inevitable feature of a free society.
I agree, and the important thing is that Parliament should act in a responsible way and shouldn't try and jump on the bandwagon. Sometimes they do. Parliament abolished the death penalty when the majority of the populace would have liked to keep it. That's a good example.
True.
Parliament sometimes leads. The penalty for driving under the influence of drink was raised by Parliament, and it altered the attitude to that particular offence. When I was young, everyone thought it was perfectly all right. And smoking as well, another example.
Right. We've done our 10 minutes. So, hands up. The question is, does public opinion have too much influence on sentencing? Hands up those of you who think it does. Right, I'm not going to be very scientific about this. And hands up those who think it doesn't have too much. Ah, very interesting. So the doesn'ts have it. Yes, good. Okay, we're on to a completely different subject now, which is it going to be up here? Yes, marvellous. Is adversarial litigation the best way of resolving civil disputes? Roger.
Well,
define terms first, and
right,
then,
yes.
And then
I should declare an interest. I've written a book called Why Restorative Justice, and I don't think that adversarial disputes, especially in the civil courts, are necessarily the best way. There are situations in which mediation isn't appropriate. For example, if there's a huge polluter that's ruining the farms around them, taking a Dorset example, you know, it isn't enough to sort of pay off the victims. There should be a day in court for the little guy, as it were, and that's the kind of a case that shouldn't be handled. But time and time again, things that cost people a fortune, a huge amount of court time, is spent on something that reasonable people ought to sit down and sort. And with good lawyers and good mediators and goodwill, that's possible. I went to Winnipeg and saw in the court there, they had an hour before the case came to court to solve the problem and save the money and so on. And time and time, it was like 70% of the cases were sorted in an hour. I liked that.
Okay, David Neuberger.
Well, certainly, I think that any system should include mediation and other ways of trying to resolve disputes in a friendly way. But in the end, some disputes are unresolvable. And those that are unresolvable, I think, are best resolved, subject to one point, under our system, where each side presents its case through an expert lawyer who identifies the best arguments of fact and law and puts them before a judge. And the judge then, having the benefit of both sides' case put as well as possible, determines who's right. The one problem with our system is that it's very expensive.
Exactly. I was about to ask you about that.
The answer to that is partially that we can make our system of justice in court cheaper by cutting out, in small cases, certain procedures that cost a lot. Under our system, both sides produce masses of documents. Now, in big cases worth tens of millions of pounds, that may be justified. In small cases, it isn't. In all our cases, we allow cross-examination, which can go on for a day or two. That should, in smaller cases, be stopped. Lawyers in this country are arguably the best in the world. They cost a lot because of that. And I think we have to find systems whereby either you have cheap lawyers or you don't have lawyers at all to determine cases. We do have a small claims court where small cases are argued often by individuals. Young barristers and solicitors are now doing cases for nothing to get the experience. And I think we need to build on that to keep our adversarial system. If we go over to a system where judges simply decide cases without lawyers involved, A, it won't be as effective, and B, it will lead to us having to have a lot more judges and the cost of lawyers going down to the public, but the cost of judges and courts, because judges will have to spend more time on every case, going up.
Nicholas.
Yes, well, the adversarial system is undoubtedly best for the lawyers, but I don't agree with David. There's no way we can afford the adversarial system except for very big cases. Okay. The inquisitorial system, there's only one person really involved, and that's the judge. There are lawyers, but they have a much lower involvement. In our country, you have to have an expensive lawyer on each side. Lawyers are expensive. They're always going to be expensive because they're very highly skilled. And they argue the case, and then the judge decides. So you have a minimum of three professional people deciding the case, but very often you have solicitors, you have barristers, you have expert witnesses. It's wonderful. It's wonderful. It's a Rolls-Royce system. We'd all love to go to Waitrose in a chauffeur-driven Rolls-Royce, but most of us have to go in our own family car or even on a bicycle.
Or go to Tesco, even.
Or go to Tesco. Middle. There we are. So I think it's the ideal system, but we simply can't afford it.
And also, there is often a built-in asymmetry. You know, you've got a big corporation on one side, you've got the little man on the other side.
Well, sometimes.
I mean,
sometimes you have enormous rich Russians on both sides. Then let them come here and pay all the lawyers. That's wonderful. Yeah. And you know, it helps the tax, too.
But David was saying that a judge-led system would be less effective. Why would it be less? I mean, do you disagree that it would be?
Yes. The adversarial system is the best system if you're just judging it by the result. But you can't just judge by the result. You've got to have regard to what it costs. And money going to the lawyers is money down the drain. It doesn't do anyone any good except the lawyers.
I think that's slightly unfair. You're paying lawyers to present your case as well as they can. And as you accept, they do that better than a judge on his or her own. And my concern is that if you've got a judge who's got to investigate the matter, get all the documents, interrogate the people involved, all supported by a civil service, it will actually end up costing more than cutting down the system and making it much more efficient, but keeping the adversarial system.
Can I just say, yes, the one thing I do feel about this is that the win-lose system means that there's a loser. And if the loser resents it and doesn't accept the verdict, then you've got more problems. You've got appeals, you've got this goes on. Or the relationship between, say, a landlord and a tenant is poisoned. And therefore, the great thing about mediation is that both sides, in the end, accept. They may not get what they want, but they get enough so that they don't keep after each other in a negative way.
What you're saying is don't have disputes, and that's very wise advice.
but do you disagree that an inquisitorial system could actually end up being more expensive?
I think it could, but I don't think it does on the continent.
Exactly.
And Roger, are you, if mediation doesn't work, do you think we should use an inquisitorial system rather than an adversarial one?
I do, actually, yes. I mean, I just think that the legal superstructure which lawyers have created and lawyers in Parliament protect isn't subject to the test of efficiency and so on. David's right that that's obviously an ideal situation, but I'm worried about the little person who can't afford it and whose rights are at stake. And yes, they should have a protection in court, and they do get it, but now when they've taken lawyers away from the family courts, for example, you know, the whole thing goes on forever while people represent themselves. That's nonsense.
Right.
That's what happens if you don't have lawyers. That's my point.
Let's put it to the vote. Okay, hands up those of you who believe that adversarial litigation is the best way of resolving civil disputes. Well, we can't be too nuanced. Okay, and those who think it's not the best way? Well, I'd say a majority for not.
I think so.
Yeah, a smaller majority than in the previous question, but nonetheless. Okay, here's a good one. Are juries the best way of trying crime? And we're going to start with David Neuberger.
I think the first important point to bear in mind is that you don't want the whole court system to be manned simply by lawyers. And I want lawyers involved, but you don't. I want lawyers involved, but I don't want them exclusively involved.
Yep.
And I think that if you take away juries, you are taking away a very valuable involvement of the average non-lawyer in the system. A, that's important because it means that people have more confidence in the system. It isn't just judges deciding, it's your peers deciding. B, it's actually more acceptable to the defendant, the criminal, because he or she feels that they are having their peers deciding it. C, I think that you have people who, on the whole, not everyone who's been on a jury is impressed, but most people who've been on juries, in my experience, are impressed, and they go back and understand a bit more about the legal system, can tell people about it. And the same argument, of course, applies to having lay magistrates and not just lawyers. And I think we give that up at our peril. I know that having juries on cases makes cases last longer. Judges can deal with things more quickly. I know that juries sometimes reach unexpected results. Dare I say it, so do judges. And I personally think that it's an important feature of our system that we will lose at our peril.
In your years of sitting as a judge, have you found in general that juries have reached what you consider to be the right verdict?
I didn't do that much criminal work, but no jury ever reached a conclusion that I thought was silly or perverse. I had two juries who convicted when I would have acquitted, and I had two juries who actually acquitted when I would have convicted. And I thought they, in each case, they arrived at rational decisions.
Nicholas.
Juries are an absurd way of trying crime. Who on earth would invent them? They came around by accident. In the old days, we didn't have criminal investigation. The judge would go out to the country when there'd been a crime, and he'd call together some of the locals because they'd know what happened. And they would be the jury, and he'd say, well, who did it? And they would say, he did it, and he would be convicted. Now juries aren't allowed to know anything about the crime at all. It's a historical accident that we still got them. We had them for civil cases as well. What's David got to say about that? It's dangerous to take away the common man. We took them away in civil cases because everyone recognized that they weren't competent. They still have them in the States. They award massive, absurd amounts of damages. They then have to go to the Court of Appeal and have it put right. Now, sometimes juries are jolly good and sometimes they're bad, but who knows whether they're too sick to handle the case or not. Nobody's allowed to ask them. They don't have to do an exam. So sometimes you get the right answer and sometimes you don't. I tried two fraud cases that went on for over half a year, each one. How can you justify taking 12 men and women and making them sit for over half a year to try and sort out something that's almost too complicated for a rarely trained legal mind? I think complete nonsense having juries.
Brilliant. Roger.
Well, I think we need a bit of perspective about this. Of all the criminal charges that are brought against people, the juries appear for only in 1% of the processing those charges, 1% of criminal charges. Of those that people bring to court, to Crown Court, only 12% are done by juries, right? So in fact, in that sense, it's quite a sort of small proportion, but it's for people's liberty that's being at stake. And in that sense, I agree with David that the democratic participation of ordinary people is very important to protect the rights of individuals whose lives are at stake. However, there is a problem about understanding. And the research that's been done on juries, and it was done actually for the MOJ 2010, a woman called Cheryl Thomas at the University College, wrote a report called Are Juries Fair? And dealt with all the prejudices which people have against juries, some of which we've just heard. for example, that they're biased against black and ethnic minority defendants. They're biased against women. They don't convict in rape cases. They don't. Some juries in courts like Snaresbrook and so on wouldn't convict at all. They're reluctant to convict because it's their neighbors, the locals. None of that's true. They will convict racists. The tests that have been done are not proving any more prejudice against black and ethnic minority. So in that sense, they are fair, but they're a small proportion of cases. And what Nick has described, and I totally support, was something called restorative justice, but people have to plead guilty, it has to be voluntary, and then they sit around, I've seen in Northern Canada, the whole village sits around and decides what should happen to the offender and what should happen to protect the victim. And it's called circle sentencing, and it's the principle of it, which is very touching, I think, is that the purpose of the justice system is to close the circle broken by crime. That's what I'd like to see happen.
Sorry. Don't you think that there's actually something fundamental about which a lot of people in this country at least feel, about the right to be tried by your fellow citizens? And that if that were lost in the criminal courts, at least, people would feel that it was a loss of their liberties.
I think it's really instilled in this nation that trial by jury is absolutely the only way of trying serious crime. It's a protection against the prejudiced judge who sits there day after day after day, and after a time he never believes a word that any defendant says.
Yeah.
It's a protection against government for creating offences which stick in the gullet of the common man, some of the whistleblowing offences, for instance, so they won't convict, even though it's quite plain that the individual is guilty. So there are good sides to juries as well as problems.
But there is one thing I should throw in from this research, is interesting. Even the jurors who said they did understand the judge's instructions, only a third of them did. Most of the others did not. And unless they're given written instructions and also told very clearly, don't go on the internet, there's a kind of polluting of the purity of the system that needs addressing.
Do you think there's a case perhaps not to have juries in very complicated trials such as fraud? I mean, 6 months seems a bit
long.
I think
there are all sorts of interesting ideas about what one can do with a jury, which we don't do. We are pathetic about permitting people to interview jurors to see what they're doing. Roger's given one or two examples where it's rarely been permitted. I think it'd be very interesting. For instance, it's a very good point on long fraud cases. Should we have a jury consisting of fewer number of people who understand accounts and so on? Should we have juries like they have in the Channel Islands, who sit with the judge and don't sit across the room and he talks to them and doesn't really know what they're thinking, and they may not ask him the judge a question. Should they sit with the judge and form a little committee with the judge? I think there are all sorts of things one could do along that line. But I do think it's very dangerous to say juries don't have them in most other countries. I think one mistake that people often make is to think because something works in another country, you can simply uproot it and bring it here. It's like a gardener thinking there's a wonderful flower in Central Africa and I'll bring it here. It's different soil and different climate, and different things work in different countries.
Well, it's a slightly different climate in Northern Ireland, but not much. And in the Troubles, they had away with juries because of the sectarian influence in a case. And they had something called diplock trials, where it would be the judge alone who tried cases.
Hated by a lot of people in Northern Ireland.
On the contrary, quite a lot of criminals, in some cases they had the option, and they would vote for a diplock trial because they knew that the judge would have to give reasons for convicting them. Couldn't do it off the seat of his pants because he was quite sure they were guilty.
But that's another point. I'd see no reason why you can't say to a person who's going to be tried, you can have a judge alone or a jury. Yeah. It's your choice.
Yeah. Yes.
But you still need the jury system.
They do have that.
They do. Well, they don't if it's not an each way crime. Yeah, if it's murder, you can't go for a judge alone. True. And I think you should be able to.
And now that the rules have been tightened up on jury service, so it's much harder for middle-class professional people to get out of it, presumably that is, you were talking about juries being too thick, presumably that is actually raising the calibre of juries, isn't it?
I think the clever people got out of being jurors, so I think that's right.
They used to, but I don't think they can't really, much harder to now. Yes.
You know, actually, David's right in one sense, because the average person I've never met who... Well, he is the president of the Supreme Court. we have to hope he's right most of the time. I just, on the business of people understanding the justice system and the sort of ripple effect from that is really quite impressive. The people I know who've been on jury duty, they remember it and they talk about it, and that's at least some opening up of this closed subject.
And if jurors don't understand the judge's directions, is that not the judge's fault for not explaining clearly enough?
The short answer to it is that the jury should say to the judge, we don't understand, should send the judge a note, and the judge should then explain. Sometimes it's the judge's fault, sometimes, dare I say it, it's the appeal court's fault for making the direction, the law too complicated.
Yeah, the law is complicated, and in any case involving complicated law, the judge now has to give the jury a kind of questionnaire to answer.
Exactly.
If the answer's yes, go to question two. If the answer's no, acquit. And spoon feed them like that.
Yeah. Help them, I think we call it.
Yes, exactly.
Guide them.
Right, okay. Let's put this to the vote then. So the question is, are juries the best way of trying crime? Those of you who agree that they are the best way, please put your hands up. I think that's going to win, but let's see who thinks they aren't. Pretty overwhelming majority. Sorry, old chap.
That represents the firm belief of the man in the street, as it were, about juries. And however brilliantly you argue that we shouldn't have them, you don't get anywhere. I should just add that David and I agreed beforehand that we got to have some controversy here. So I would say that it's a bad idea to have juries.
I have to give Nick his due. He volunteered to take that side.
It's true, we didn't press gang you. Okay, so the fourth question is, has the advent of the Supreme Court made a difference to the justice system? Now, you were the very first president of it, and you can now, having retired, look back. What do you say?
We didn't have a Supreme Court to make a difference, a real difference to the justice system. One reason we had a Supreme Court was because Tony Blair reckoned it was a good way of getting rid of his Lord Chancellor, who had resigned if he introduced a Supreme Court. But don't quote me on that. But it was supposed to be a seamless transition of the 12 most senior judges in the land out of Parliament, across the square, into the Supreme Court. And it worked seamlessly. We went on doing the same job very much in the same way. The difference is that people are beginning to understand that we have a Supreme Court and what it does.
So is it just a change of premises, then?
Not just a change of premises. It's transparency now. The Supreme Court's hearings are available on television for anyone who wants to watch them. People are encouraged to go in. There's a sandwich board outside saying, come inside, look around, come and see what's going on. The press now say, well, the Supreme Court is going to decide this. I wonder how many people here had any idea who the law lords were or how they worked. Quite a complicated concept. Nobody abroad did, and quite a lot of people in this country didn't either. The Supreme Court is easier to understand. They are beginning to work, I think, more collectively, more as a college of a court, whereas when they were in Parliament, in theory, each was giving his own speech in a debate about whether the appeal should be allowed or dismissed. That's what used to happen. Everyone in the House of Lords could take part. Absolute pandemonium, I should think. But the form remained the same, individual speeches. Now you can have a joint judgment much more easily.
David.
Yes, I agree with that. I think it's a perception more than the effect. I mean, people may think it's had an effect because it's the Supreme Court came into existence around the same time as we had devolution, which has given the courts more, particularly the Supreme Court, a more constitutional power when it decides what the Scottish government or the Welsh or the Northern Irish government can do and what Whitehall can do. And when we also, with human rights coming into force, the Human Rights Act coming into force, that makes us look as if we've got greater power. But the creation of the Supreme Court itself hasn't made a difference, but in terms of judicial power, but it's made a lot of difference to the perception and public being aware of it. We do little things like producing for anyone who visits a summary of the case that's being heard so you can understand in ordinary language what the case is about. We produce summaries of our judgments, which often run to 50 pages, but the summaries never run to more than 2 pages, explaining the essential points. Everything is filmed, and you can get DVDs of hearings. You'd have to be a bit sad to want them, or a lawyer. Maybe that's the same thing.
Yes.
And on top of that, we read out a very brief summary of our judgment in each case and give it to the television news channels so it can be broadcast. We tweet. We have 180,000 followers. Ooh. We have moots when undergraduates and students and pupils from school come and debate a point of law as if they were in court in front of me or one of my colleagues. I did one yesterday, so they have that experience. 500,000 people have visited the court over its 5.5 years of existence, so 6.5 years of existence so far. And we have 4.5 stars on TripAdvisor. which I think some of my colleagues are slightly embarrassed about. And I might add, we also have a very good cafe. But I think generally we are more accessible and people know what we are. And as Nicholas says, as the Supreme Court, unlike the Law Lords, it's what it says on the tin. We are the Supreme Court and people should be aware of us. They're aware of the law. We are out more. And hopefully people will understand what we do better.
But could all these things have happened had you just remained in the House of Lords?
It would have been much more difficult because we were part of the House of Lords. We were not independent. We couldn't do our own thing. We were clerk of the House of Lords who looked after us. Technically, the Law Lords were not a court. We were not judges. We were a committee of the House of Lords, like a Foreign Affairs Committee. And when we decided on an appeal as Law Lords, as Nicholas said, we went into the chamber of the House of Lords, a rather cross bishop having to get up at 10 o'clock in the morning to open the proceedings, as they always do.
With prayers.
And we solemnly voted on whether to allow the appeal or dismiss the appeal. And it was archaic, it was curious, and we were very difficult to get to because security was considerable. Now it is much more available to the public. Anybody can come in very easily.
But constitutionally, you haven't... it looks like you've been more physically separated from the legislature, but in practice it hasn't made any difference, has it, to the way the law functions?
I don't think it's made any real difference the way the law functions. In the long term, I thought it might. I have to say I was slightly concerned about that. But I think certainly in the short and medium term, it hasn't made any difference. We are now on the... On the west side of Parliament Square, so you've got the church on the south side, the legislature on the east side, the civil service on the north side, and the law on the west side, and we have our own identity.
That's very neat. Roger?
I know that it's bad debating practice to agree with the other parties, but I'm afraid in this case that I do. But I think that with typical modesty, they're both understating the impact I think that the court has already had. And one of the problems, which is a very interesting one, and I've, as an ex-American, I've been aware of the fact that people keep referring to the British Constitution and as if it were a document like the American one. And the question about rights was also, because it's bandied about, either because people think their rights have been infringed. I went to a lecture that Ronnie Dworkin gave a long time ago saying that people think of rights like things
the suitcases, God-given rights. You're born with a suitcase full of rights. And there was once the AA, when Barbara Castle was bringing in seatbelts, saying the AA protested against the infringement of the right to unfettered motoring. Well, I think the Supreme Court would have things to say about that. And that's just the point, that the, what became a sort of rather marginalized conversation about rights when the British adopted the European Charter of Human Rights and so on and became the Human Rights Act, there was still a feeling that it was only for Guardian readers. Nobody really cared. And actually what these guys have done is make rights into a practical, debated, serious tool to consider what should happen, say, to a tenant who's being evicted either improperly or properly by a landlord, whether it's public or not. The one I went to in the Supreme Court was about just that. And the question was, in Article 8, the right to a family life and decent housing should be understood by public authorities, but perhaps not by private authorities. Now, that's something that affects everybody who has a house, who is a tenant. And yet, there's Article 8 being debated on their behalf by these very intelligent, thoughtful people, quoting, and I am now serious, they quoted Andorran, Swedish, Croatian, and Austrian courts to see what the European Court of Human Rights had to say. And I just thought, hello, we are actually taking rights seriously. And with the Brexit coming up and an attempt to rewrite this whole notion of British human rights, I think it's really important. And things like joint enterprise, which they shot down and said had been misunderstood 30 years ago, and there are lots of people serving life or long sentences for that, telling the security services you can't have secret hearings about people who are being accused of terrorist thoughts. These are very serious matters, and they take them very seriously and do it in a transparent way. And that strikes me as justice at its best.
Are there now fewer cases that go all the way to Strasbourg because of the existence of the Supreme Court, or is it just the same as when the Lords was doing it?
Because of the
Human Rights Act. Yes.
Far less. Yes,
but that's because of the Human Rights Act, not because of the Supreme Court.
The House of Lords were applying the Human Rights Act.
Yes, yeah.
Yes.
Do you think there should be more women Supreme Court justices?
Certainly, yes. I mean, we've got one out of 12. It's lamentable.
It is, isn't it?
I hope, and I have no doubt in the future, and I hope in the near future, there will be more. It reflects... It's a defensive point, but it reflects the fact that we select our judges from the best judges, and the best judges are in turn reflected from the top of largely the bar, but also a bit the solicitors. And if you look at the bar, I think 13% of the QCs are women. And there is a problem that they have and should be doing something about. And it's not a boast, but it is an improvement. The number of High Court judges, that's the first rank of senior judges, who are women, are now over 20%. So steps have been taken to improve things. But obviously, they ought to be 50%. And you can also make the point that we are very weak on ethnic minorities. I think the biggest problem, which is a problem throughout the country, which I don't know how we deal with, is what in old days we call what amounts to background, people who come from poorer backgrounds in terms of family and education are very underrepresented, and that is the biggest problem. But you're quite right. The proportion of women in the Supreme Court is 1 out of 12. It's not good.
Could you select Supreme Court justices also from academia?
Yes.
And are there more senior women law professors?
I haven't done a trial. There are certainly some very distinguished female law professors, yes. And certainly We are not restricted to practicing lawyers. At the moment, the Constitutional Reform Act does make it more difficult for pure academics who have no professional qualifications or experience. And that is something we're looking at. But that would require a statutory change.
Right.
Yes, I just wanted to throw in something about this. Of course, they need more women. But the research on jurors, which was done using simulated, real jurors, but simulated cases, found that women jurors were much more likely to change their minds than men. Men wouldn't.
On the basis of the evidence, you mean?
On the basis of the evidence, exactly.
Good, well, you want that,
not
don't
just
we?
Persuasion. No, no, but I just thought that's an extra reason for having women judges.
Yes. So. Nicholas?
Does that mean they're indecisive or open-minded?
Open-minded.
No, open-minded, I think, if the facts change, maybe.
No, we want a collegiate court, David, don't you?
We must have have more women, and we will, I'm sure.
Good. Right, let's put this to the vote, and then we're going to have a good session of Q&A, I hope. So has the advent of the Supreme Court made a difference to the justice system? Hands up, those of you who think it has. And those who think it hasn't? Well, the has-is have it. So, well done. Right, now, we're going to have questions and answers. And there are going to be two roving mics. There are students here in very fetching pink hoodies. Hands up. I'll choose two people to start with to ask the first two questions. So hands up, don't be shy. Yes, gentlemen here and here in the second row. After that, I'll look in this direction. Could you tell us who you are, please?
Yes, John Sack, and I do admit to being a friend of at least two of the people on the panel. am I allowed to ask a question this way? Would you put the question about juries again, but only to the people who've served on juries?
Okay, why not? So the question is, are juries the best way of conducting, the best way of trying crime? Those of you who've been on juries and think it's the best way, put your hands up. And those of you who've been on juries and think it's not the best way? Interesting. Yes. Okay. So you were impressed by your experience on juries. That was a very good question. Thank you. And the gentleman here.
Brilliant question. My name's David Latham. I have an interest to declare, namely, that I was vice president of the Court of Appeal Criminal Division before I retired. To what extent does the panel consider that our sentencing system is distorted by the fact that, for example, a four-year sentence of imprisonment may only result in a year in served after sentence because the sentence is halved and the prisoner has been in custody for a year pending trial?
Would you like to start with that, Nick?
I think distortion may be the right word. If you're talking about the difference between what happens in practice and what anyone reading the newspaper and seeing somebody's been sentenced to 6 years imprisonment thinks is going to happen, you're absolutely right. Because first of all, if he's been in custody for a year, that counts as if he's had 2 years, because the basic rule is you come out halfway through, unless there's good reason for keeping you in, and most prisoners come out halfway through. So you're sentenced to prison for 6 years, but you come out after three. You're liable to go back if you misbehave, but you don't serve the apparent sentence. It's a bit of a confidence trick.
On the other hand, if everybody served the 6 years that they were sentenced to, there would be no incentive for them to behave well in jail, because they only get let out halfway through if for good behaviour.
Right.
So jails would become pretty much unmanageable, wouldn't they?
You're released automatically after you've served half the sentence.
Really? I thought it was remission for good behaviour.
No.
Sorry, it shows how ignorant I am.
It's a misunderstanding.
Okay.
And that's one of the reasons, because the distortion is not simply because what the sentence is isn't quite what will happen in practice.
Sorry, I should have insisted.
Sorry,
on that.
The distortion is also because there is a temptation as a result to over-sentence, in my view.
Yes.
So there's a double distortion built into the system. And I think that we ought to be considering carefully, or rather more carefully than we have, whether it's right to go on saying it's a sentence of 4 years imprisonment, or we ought to be saying you will serve 4 years, 2 years in custody, and 2 years on license. In other words, making it absolutely clear that there is a separation between the two parts of the sentencing system.
Do you agree with that?
Absolutely.
David?
I agree with that. I mean, David Latham has had far, far more experience both of sentencing and of the subsequent events as his involvement with the parole board shows. But I have to say that I think this is an example of the law and the media interacting. I think that you can make the sentence sound worse than it is to keep the media happy, but have a lower sentence in practice. And I think the law should never be dishonest. And I think a much more honest and open way of doing it is precisely the way that David Latham has said. You say it is 4 years, but the second half is on license. In the same way, very similarly, you might say you'll have 2 years suspended. Mm. So you'll have 2 years in practice. The second 2 years is like a suspended sentence. I think then you'd get 4 years, but you would be able to be honest about what it really involved.
Roger.
Well, I think the real question is, what is the sentence for? And then you have to ask the question, I think, it's to get people to stop doing whatever they were doing, the harm that they were doing. That's the most important thing. And I was asked by a newspaper to interview judges and recorders and sentencers at the time of Strangeways to find out why they sent them to prison. I interviewed 14 of all ranks, and even Michael Argyle, who was famous, he said to me, he was to the right of Genghis Khan. He said that after the first day or two, the first week, when you hear the clang of the door and you feel you've lost your liberty, he said from then on, that really the influence of prison is, you know, the same and negative. And the Tory government had passed this, the Criminal Justice Act of 91, and the green paper before it said, prison is an expensive way of making bad people worse. So if we want people to stop, then the kind of sentence that you've described, conditional, qualifying what it is that people earn in the way of freedom, it stands a better chance. But it's really to get them to stop. And sending them to prison is, I think, rather hopeless because the recidivism rate is so bad that if it was the same for the NHS, we'd all be dead.
Right, more questions. Yes? Mine here, and sorry, I'm going to ask for two so we can get another mic. Yes, over there, the one in front, and then I'll take the chap behind. So,
down here.
Down here, second row, put your hand up, please. Thank you.
Hi there, my name's Jack. So I have a question specifically for Lord Phillips, but also for the rest of the panel. So we were talking about right to legal representation by a professional lawyer. We were talking about the benefits or otherwise of juries. Now, I think everybody was saying that it's a pretty good idea to have representation by lawyers. It's a good idea to have the ability to be tried by 12 members of the public, and that's a sort of, as you mentioned, a citizen's right as well. And that is something which, you said it was a historical accident, but it does have sort of ancient basis in lots of civilizations which sort of came up with this, you know, in Greece and Rome. These are quite fundamental things, but you also mentioned cost. And I suppose my question there is, you know, what is the cost at which point the benefit of these things, you know, it's not sufficient? You know, what's the cost of the average case? And at what point are these almost fundamental rights, in many ways, as we've been thinking of them, I think, you know, in recent years, at what point is that negated by the huge cost?
It's much easier, I think, to put a cost analysis in relation to civil proceedings, because you can say, what's at stake in this case is £25,000. What it's going to cost if you have a solicitor and a barrister on each side and the case is fought is going to be £75,000. Ergo, it really is not worth the candle. Although justice is important, we've got to find another way of resolving your difference rather than this very expensive mechanism. Now, what price do you put on being sent to prison? That you can't really cost. And so people who are charged with a criminal offence have got to be given the legal assistance they need to defend that charge. And that's a fundamental, I think, of a criminal justice system.
Though, of course, less and less money is being made available for legal aid.
Yes.
Is this a worry?
It is a worry, yes. But you still get legal assistance if you're charged with a criminal offence.
The cost of prison is something that Jack has raised, should be factored into this. I did the numbers for Feltham, where I was filming, and it cost about 48 grand a year to keep a prisoner there. And that's twice the price of Eton or Winchester, or staying overnight at the Ritz for a year. And it occurred to me, looking at these young people who were just, you know, scrambling to make some kind of living, why don't we just give them the money? And then they won't have to steal it. And then
that
they
would go down well with the Daily Mail, wouldn't it?
Well,
Actually, there are an awful lot of people who have made very successful careers being bent. No, all I'm saying is that the absurdity is not just the courts, it's actually the prisons. The prisons, in my view, are a total waste of money.
Yes.
I think that we discovered through the human rights and the European law a concept of proportionality, which the continental judges use,
yes,
we've now brought into our system, we've embraced. And I think that Nicholas's example of £25,000 claim, which cost £75,000 to litigate, is absolutely apt. I think if you have a case like that, the judge, with adversarial system or whatever system, says to the parties, this case is not going to cost more than £15,000. Go away and present your case, prepare your case on that basis. And that's how I would deal with it. Criminal cases are more difficult for the reason that you can't price them. But in the end, society has to decide how much it's prepared to spend on criminal cases, and that will influence how much money is devoted to a particular criminal case in terms of prosecuting and defending.
Should we have more cases decided by magistrates who are presumably cheaper?
I think the balance between the magistrate and the Crown Court is probably about right, but I have to say that one of the disadvantages of the Supreme Court is you're away from the sharp end. And therefore, for me to pontificate on that sort of point in 2016, when I've been where I've been for over 3 years and in the Court of Appeal for another three, is a bit dangerous. But I think it's about right.
I don't think magistrates are cheaper either, actually.
Oh.
If you have a professional district judge instead of three magistrates.
I think magistrates rather than juries, I think.
Yes.
Rather than juries.
One last point on this, which is that I said I interviewed 14 judges and recorders and so on. All of them said that the only reason they sent people to prison, unless they were really dangerous, was because they didn't know what else to do. And it seems to me it's our responsibility to find them other things to do. That's what I've spent the last 20 years trying to do.
Great. Okay, now there's two questions over here, but let's have the first.
Hello, I'm James Vaughan. I'm the Deputy Chief Constable here in Dorset. A senior investigating officer on Operation Midland recently described a witness's account as credible and true. Which seemed to have sparked a debate nationally around whether law enforcement agencies and prosecutors should believe victims. I'll be interested in the panel's view on the presumption to believe victims.
Roger.
Well, I think that was shocking, absolutely shocking. It's the job of the police to assess evidence on a fair basis, on a neutral basis. And you know very well that for cases like the Ripper case, where they expected something else, it was a hoax being put on them. So they had Sutcliffe in their hands 9 times. And it was only by accident that they found the right guy. It was a traffic stop. So what happens when that kind of attitude comes in, where you believe people either universally or disbelieve them universally, as very often in rape cases, is a distortion of justice and it's a misuse of process.
David?
The pressures on the police are enormous. I think the judges do get into the papers with criticism a bit, but the police are much more in the public eye, and one has to start off with the fact that one has considerable sympathy for them. I think that it is not their business, though, to describe a witness, particularly in public, as true, what they say is true. That's not their job to decide. I think they do have to decide on credibility to the extent of thinking, is there potentially enough in this allegation for us to investigate it. That is part of their job.
Yes.
How much they should go and say things in public is a very difficult exercise in today's media-ridden world, and I wouldn't want to advise. But I think credible I can understand, true I can't.
Nicholas?
I quite agree. It's a different situation when you're being attacked for something you've already done and trying to justify yourself. And in that situation, it's fair enough to say we thought the evidence was credible, but not to say the evidence was true. That's the job for the jury.
Exactly.
Yes, the man behind you.
Jeremy Pope, an erstwhile liar who soiled his hands with commerce. I just wanted to ask, in the context of adversarial litigation in civil cases, what the panel's view is of those cases where the lawyer acting, I'm thinking perhaps particularly in employment law cases, operates on the basis of no foul, no fee. or some participative arrangement in the compensation that that individual receives.
Very interesting.
Yes, well, I'll start with you, David.
I think the old-fashioned system, where the lawyer had no interest in the outcome, he or she got a fee or a sum of money, whether the case was a complete disaster or a complete success, was a very good one, because it meant the lawyer had no interest in the outcome and therefore could, while doing his or her best for the client, wouldn't be tempted to do anything wrong or cheat or whatever. And I think the fact that we have a no-win, no-fee system is unfortunate. Having said that, you have to accept that the amount of money which society is prepared to give over to law is a matter of government policy. We could have the old-fashioned system in the past because money was made available to litigants through the legal aid system. Legal aid has been shrunk in the civil side almost to vanishing point, and the only way people can get to a court is through a no-win, no-fee. The problem with that is it comes back to Nicholas Phillips' example of the £25,000 claim. Unless you have a very, very efficient and simple system, there's not enough at stake for the lawyer to get his or her fee out of the £25,000. So it's a double problem. You're actually denying people justice in many cases, and when you are giving them justice through a no-win, no-fee system, you are getting, by no means always, but you're in danger of getting less reliable lawyers.
What do you think?
I agree. I think no-win, no-fee is a compromise, really, dealing with the fact that we're removing legal aid. And if you don't have this kind of system, then the litigant's not going to be able to afford a lawyer at all. But it's an unsatisfactory compromise.
Yeah, the real problem, I think, about legal aid is not just in the examples that you talked about, but in the family courts, for example, you only get legal aid if there's domestic violence. So, of course, there's an incentive to allege domestic violence.
Or your husband, yeah, 80%.
No, I didn't use a gender. I was very careful not to. But the point is simply that what the consequences of this apparent saving of legal aid is not only to deprive people of proper legal representation, which may affect their life completely, the custody of their children, all sorts of issues which are life-changing, but also the delays in the family courts when people are representing themselves is using up the money that was apparently saved. It's a nonsense. I wish they'd revoke it.
Right. Two more questions. Ooh, great. The man at the back and the one right here in the middle.
Hello. My name's Edward. I'm studying my legal practice course here at the moment. Addressing the panel at large, one day I'd like to become a district judge if everything goes well, or badly, depending on how you look at it. But as active members of the judicial system, or generally intelligent people, if you could change a single thing about the justice system at the moment, what would it be and why?
Good question. David, I'll start with you.
I feared you might do that. If I could change, I'm not sure. There are lots of things that one would like to change. I think I would change the system whereby we have to have such expensive litigation because we have the rules which require expensive litigation, and permit judges to say, as I've indicated, you will not spend more than this on a certain case, and family and civil. If I were outside the judge's role, I would like to think that we as a society could afford more legal aid for the reasons that have been discussed. And if I can go yet wider in terms of my remit and the justice system as a whole, I would be very keen to look at something more satisfactory, more efficient, more effective, more humane than putting more and more people in prison for longer and longer.
Yes, Nick.
The last point first, I would halve the length of prison sentences, and I would let out a lot of people who are in prison at the moment who shouldn't be there at all. But so far as civil justice is concerned, I would introduce compulsory mediation, because it's a controversial point, but I think if people are made to sit down with a mediator,
they will very often settle their differences when they would never have conceived that that might happen.
I think your thunder's been stolen.
No, it has, absolutely, but I want to extend that. In Australia, New Zealand, Finland, Canada, it is every case, the victim in every case is offered restorative justice, and I would want to extend it from the youth justice system where it exists already to the whole of the criminal justice system. Everybody who's been a victim of crime should have a chance to meet their offender, if possible, and find out why it happened to them, because the justice system doesn't explain that.
Good, very good answers. Yes, could you wait for the mic to come to you? Oh, okay, all right. So two more. I promise to look to the left and right this time. Yes, right at the back there and right at the front here. Oh, it wasn't you, sorry. Anyone on this side? Yes, okay, so you could be next.
Hello, my name's Suzanne. I just wanted to pose this question to the panel. Do they agree with the Prime Minister's calls for reform for female prisoners who are either pregnant or are sentenced and they have their children in custody in prison?
Okay. I'd like to ask you to be quick so we can get one more question in and still finish on time.
I can be quick. Yes.
David.
I can't pretend to know enough about it, but it sounds to me as if it's something that needs to be done, yes.
Sounds humane, doesn't
it? It does, and therefore
yes.
Good.
Yes.
The vast majority of women are imprisoned for non-violent offences. They have no business being there, whether they're pregnant or not.
Well, they all agree with you, so that's great. And the last question was somewhere over here.
It's me.
Ah, yes, thank you.
Hello, I'm Richard Griffiths. I just wondered whether any of the panel, when in their careers at the bar or when they were Lord Chief Justice, ever came across judges that they would find unsuitable to sit as members of the jury, let alone actually have charge of a trial on their own. And I think if the answer is yes, you've probably answered the question about juries.
No names, no pack drill, but...
I can think of one, and he's still sitting as a judge.
Ooh, but only one. If it's only one, then that's pretty good, I would say.
That is pretty good, yes.
Okay.
I mean, judges varied. I was sent out to train with an old-fashioned judge who he didn't believe in himself, but he believed in the importance of his office. And we took our wives with us on circuit, and he insisted that his wife stand at the front door and bow to him when he left to go to court. I couldn't make mine do that.
Does yours? David.
As a former judge, Nick can say what he said. As a serving judge, I couldn't possibly comment.
And I'm not going to ask Roger because he hasn't been a judge.
I have, no. But no. I can quote, I did indeed film Peter Cook saying I'd rather be a judge than a minor, but I didn't have the Latin. And he said, when you're too old and you're too stupid, you can't be a minor anymore. The opposite is true for the judge.
But actually, as a corrective, I have to say, if you think of all the institutions in Britain that have been disgraced in one way or another in the last 10 years, from Parliament and the media, financial services, churches, both Catholic and C of E, actually the judiciary has managed to keep its nose pretty clean. And I think that's something that we should be grateful for. So on that note, I'm going to hand over to Cameron Hill, who's going to wind up proceedings for us.
Right, well, on behalf of Bournemouth University, its staff, its students and distinguished guests, I would like to thank the High Sheriff of Dorset for giving us this evening, also this fantastic panel for making it so interesting, and I'm almost sad that it's over, I'll be honest. I've been really enjoying this. Thought these are going to be some of the smartest, most intelligent people I've ever had the pleasure of being in the same room as. On that note, I'd also like to thank Mary Ann Sieghart for chairing the event, and I hope you'll all join us in the atrium for the reception. Thank you very much.